The comments and opinions expressed on this radio program do not constitute legal advice and do not create an attorney-client relationship. If you have a legal problem, a formal consultation will be required outside of this radio program.
This is Legal Live with Eddie and Chuck Farah. They're talking the latest legal news and answering your questions. To call Legal Live and ask Eddie and Chuck a question, grab your phone and dial 855-765-1045. That's 855-765-1045.
Welcome. Happy Saturday, everyone. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. I'm Shafalika, and I'm joined today by Eddie and Chuck. How are you gentlemen doing today?
It's all good, Shafalika. Good to be here.
Doing well.
Good to be anywhere.
That's true. Good to be anywhere.
Yeah, believe it. Okay, so we're going to talk about, I got some stuff I want to talk about. Of course, your phone calls are a priority.
Yes, that's absolutely.
You're a priority. None of us here are. And so if you've got a question, hopefully we'll try to answer it for you. We try to get back to everybody. When we cannot answer it, we have attorney friends we can reach out to. They can hopefully get you an answer, or we can try to call you back and give you that information. I know last week we had Diane, who had a lot of questions, interesting case, mm-hmm. dealing with an estate issue. We're personal injury lawyers. We know a little bit about that, but we got her in contact with an attorney that knows what he's talking about, that knows that stuff inside and out, and hopefully he was able to help her.
Right.
So that's what we're here to do. If we can't get the help, we can find somebody to help you. Mm-hmm. And that's what it's all about. But I think we already have a caller.
We already do have a caller.
Okay, well, all right.
Well,
they're a priority.
All right. Well, let's
let me see if I can live up to what I was talking about. Go ahead.
Well, you started it. Now you got to pay it off.
Yeah, now I got to go along with it. Okay.
So we've got Linda in Jacksonville who has a question about signing a contract for a pool. What's going on, Linda? How are you doing today?
Taking my call. I'm actually calling for my daughter. She's at work and couldn't make the call today. But last April 27, 2021, she signed a contract to have a pool built in her backyard for a cost of $105,000, which includes an enclosure. And all along these months that she's been waiting, they were backed up, and they said it'd be about 11 months before they could do the pool. And she's been talking to him about the design and fine-tuning everything, and then they're supposed to start digging next week, and she got a text 2 days ago saying, we're going to need $41,000 more, and gave an option of, if you do not agree, we are keeping your deposit. You can agree to the new price and a new contract, and the price may continue to go up, or you can renegotiate the contract to stay at $105,000, but the scope of the work and the pool would be scaled back. You have 14 days to decide.
Okay. That's a good question, what mm-hmm. you brought up. It's a very common occurrence that's going on right now. Linda, everything goes back to the four corners of the agreement and in the contract. Have you had anybody look at the contract?
Not yet.
What does the contract say about price increases?
It doesn't mention it at all.
No contingencies of any
verbally,
sort.
What? There's nothing in the contract, but they did verbally tell my daughter there would be no price increase.
Okay, well, verbally means nothing, okay? I mean, that's right. Not going to be it's a four corners of the document. What's in the written agreement, uh-huh. okay? If it says we're going to do it, now the problem is, yes. You could probably, they're going to do it for $105,000, but really, are they going to do, if now they're coming back and say it's going to cost more, what they're probably telling you is they probably got so many other jobs where they can charge the 105 plus the 41 that they don't want to do your job is what they're telling you. You see what I'm saying? Because your job now, for some reason, is not as profitable as the other jobs they have. So they're coming, okay. I'm just thinking how a contractor would think maybe. Maybe there are some contractors listening that can call in and give us their perspective on it, but they're probably saying there are other people that will pay me more money to do that job, and I got limited resources, limited employees. Therefore, listen, if you ain't gonna pay me the price I want, I don't want to do it.
So, how much is the, okay. the, the,
the deposit that they're not returning?
$10,500.
Yeah. So
listen.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, I mean, now that
the thing is, you could sue them. Okay, if they're not willing, but do you really want a contractor in there working on your home who can't perform? He's not going to give you what you paid for $105,000.
I mean,
messing around with your house.
The question I have: if you get the deposit back, would you move on to another contractor?
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you want the deposit back, and I think you probably have. Depending on the contract, like Eddie says, you probably will be able to get that back.
Well, what you could do is hire a lawyer to write them a letter and say, if you can't do this deal exactly the way we spec'd it for 100 and what was it, 105 grand, then I want my deposit back. And they're going to probably send you their money back because they know they can't do it or they don't want to do it for 105,000. And so you could probably get a lawyer to write you a letter for that. What I would do, I don't know if you know somebody you can reach out. You probably need a commercial lawyer, a contract lawyer to do it. And the Jacksonville Bar Association has an attorney referral service where they can refer you to somebody. And you can even talk to a lawyer there for 30 minutes for $50 who can advise you on what to do. But the advice I'm giving you, I think, is probably what he's going to tell you. And I don't really know that much about contract law, but I know a little bit. And I see this happening a lot. So.
Okay.
Yeah,
we'll certainly try that route.
Yeah, the Jacksonville Bar Association, right, will connect you with an attorney that specializes in these types of situations. So.
That's right. And Linda, their phone number is 904-399-4486.
Yeah, and they're here local, and they'll help you out.
Okay, that's great help. Thank you so much.
Yeah, see, these contracts, everything, everybody thinks about, oh, he promised me this, he promised me that. Listen, when it comes to these commercial arrangements, everything is in the four corners of the document. Whatever's in the contract, you're not allowed to, or rules, there are actually laws, rules that prevent people from saying, well, he told me this before I signed it.
Mm-hmm.
No. It's what you should do, I tell you the way to really do it, if you're investing this kind of money, when you're investing six figures, really is to take the contract to a lawyer and have him look at it. I mean, spend a couple of $100s. I mean, it won't cost much. If you're spending $100,000, you would spend a couple of hundred to have an attorney look at it to make sure that, you know, because the person who draws it up is going to draw it up to his favor, obviously.
Obviously,
if I'm preparing the contract, I want everything to favor me. So that's why it's good to have an attorney look at it and chop it up and give you his recommendations.
Right. Right. They can't change the deal once the contract's been done.
That's the deal.
Well, thank you, Linda, so much for calling.
How can you really trust a guy that says, I'm going to do it for $105,000 and says, I want another $41,000?
I know.
Come on. I mean, that's a
come
guy.
Come on
you,
now.
You don't want to deal. That's just
she wants to get that deposit back.
Yeah, that deposit.
She wants to get her in. She'll get her money back. I mean, she could file. I mean, if a lawyer, if he doesn't respond to the lawyer's letter, that's a great small claims court. She can handle that on her own, and she can.
That's true.
Believe me, she'll get it back.
And the maximum for small claims court just went up.
Yeah.
So $10,000, we can get you covered.
Yeah.
Good luck, Linda, and thank you for calling. That was a great call. You're listening to Legal Live on 104.5 WOKV. We will be right back after this quick break. Welcome back. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV. Give us a call. We'd love to hear from you. 855-765-1045. Right now, we've got a caller on the line, Michael from Mandarin. You are calling about a letter about a house. What's going on here?
Yes, my brother lives close to me, and he got a letter in the mail saying, we want to buy your house. And he thought, well, I'll check it out. So they gave him an offer of $270,000, and he said that's not enough. So without looking at the house or anything, they upped the offer to $320,000. This was maybe about 6 weeks ago. So the closing was 9 a.m. yesterday, and they had the notary come to the house. That would be my other brother's house in the villages. They did the complete deal. All the papers were signed. And then my brother is waiting to see the money in his account. It cleared. That was yesterday, 9 a.m. And now today, looking at the website for this title company, the five reviews all showed that nobody got their money. And so we checked with the notary that lives a couple miles away from the villages, and she already filed the papers.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. She already recorded the deed to show that they're the owner. But that deed can be set aside, you know, if the because it's basically a theft.
It's a theft.
They stole the house from you. So, yeah. I mean,
was he represented by a lawyer?
No, these are title companies that are doing these closings now.
Yeah. I said, hey, listen, I had a lawyer for $250. Why don't you get a lawyer? It might cost you $500.
Well, they encourage you not to get a lawyer because now they got these title companies doing the closings. There's probably not even an attorney on the other side. Did you even deal with an attorney for the buyer?
I don't know. You know, he did this on his own, and I've been... Yes.
Yeah, I got you. So what you're going to have to do now is... have you talked to anybody at the company, at the title company, as to what's holding up the funds?
No, he called up and asked about it. Didn't even ask for the confirmation number. So, no, we don't have any information from them.
Was he intended on moving out? Was he going to stay there?
No, he moved out. He took all of his stuff out of the Mandarin home and brought it to my other brother's home, who lives in the villages.
Right, right. Okay.
And he got money on a house there, which would have closed with the money funded by this house.
Right, got it. Okay. All right, so it cost him that also and all that. You're going to have to get a lawyer at this point if they're not going to pay you the money, obviously.
Yeah, let me see if they're not going to pay.
You're
going
to have to set
The closing was 9 a.m. I'm just thinking this out.
Get the money, get the money the same day. The money's
You should. I'd give it to Monday. You know, maybe they're slow in transferring the money over.
Yes.
But Monday, you know.
When you go to the website of the title company, the five reviews all said, I never got my money.
Okay,
I'm pretty sure it's a scam.
Okay, then what you should do is...
I'd go to the state attorney's office.
Yeah, you go file a criminal complaint, go to the state attorney, but get in touch with them and say, we'll transfer the house back into my name. What you should do is do another deed transfer.
Yeah, how long that would take?
You could do that. Let's see what
how
they say.
How long would that take?
They could do it the same day if they're willing to do it. If they're not willing to do it, you're going to have to file a lawsuit. I'll tell you, if you want to give me I know an attorney. I mean, listen, you're going to start spending some money now, okay? Because you're going to have to get a lawyer to get it done if they're not going to do it voluntarily. Now, the lawyer who sues them, you can probably get all that reimbursed. The judge, if you are successful, will probably make them pay you back all your attorney's fees on top of bringing the house back to you. But you're going to come out of pocket to get this. I mean, there's too much at stake. You're going to have to spend it. $320,000, you know? I know somebody that may be able to help you. If you wanted to leave your number with our producer, I can call you on Monday and give you that phone number.
Yeah, please do. Please do.
Yeah, and you could talk to him about it. And if he can't help you, well, I'll give you a couple of names. I'll give you a couple of names of people that you can talk
to. I'm pretty confident this is fraud.
I know, but...
Do you think they chose Friday as the closing date so that you wouldn't have the next day to talk to lawyers?
Could be, or that the banks are closed or other things. I mean, I know if the money is wired or sent after 2 p.m. on Friday, it may not show up in your account till Monday.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I don't know. I mean, I don't know how these banks work. You know, sometimes I've seen it before where people make a deposit, and it's after 2 o'clock or late in the afternoon, it doesn't show up that day. You may see it the next, and if it's on the weekend, you don't see it till Monday. But I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I'm not, I don't do real estate.
I don't have any hope of seeing this money.
But now you want to get the house. It's not about the money. It's about getting the house back.
Absolutely.
You're entitled to do that. And again, I'll give you a couple of names on Monday that you can talk to if people
That would be wonderful. Because I'd appreciate that very much. And I love listening to you, so I do that every Saturday morning while I drive around.
Well, I appreciate it. Thanks. And I'm sorry this happened. I'd like to know what happened. When I call you on Monday, I'll give you my cell phone number because I want to know what the ultimate result is so I can report back here on the show on Saturday and let people know what's going on.
Yes, yes. Just don't sell your home to somebody who sends you a piece of paper in the mail.
Yes.
So. That's good advice, Michael.
You
got to
have a lawyer because what'll happen is the way it should have been done, if you had a lawyer, the lawyer would say, confirm, show me the, you know, they show me the money.
Well, the money,
right.
The money would have to be in his trust account.
It'd be in his account, and then when you sign the deed, you get a check. I mean, that's how it should go. You sign the deed, here's your money, you know?
Yeah.
You don't sign the deed, you don't get the money. And if you don't have the money, you don't get the deed. So that's the way it should, that's the way it's typically done. But these guys, like you said, are taking advantage of people. So
yeah, and the real estate market here is just blowing up, and the people are getting all kind of spam mails, spam calls, emails
this is something
about their
property. Yeah, this is something the state attorney should look into and see if there's a pattern of this. This is criminal, and there should be... Hopefully they'll look into it.
They want to buy my home too, so
These guys should be. Did you get the ID of the people that came by the house? Like they give you a card or anything, or so you know who they are?
Well, again, it's my brother that did this, and he's in the villages right now with my other brother.
Right.
But, we look forward to getting the contact information on Monday.
All right, thanks. Just give it to our director producer, and I'll get it from him. Thanks.
All right. Yeah, Daniel will take your phone number in just a moment. Well, you've been listening to, I know, I can't believe it. You've been listening to Legal Life.
$20,000.
I know,
and
the
house is probably worth more than that.
Probably,
worth $400,000.
I know.
Basically a quick
man, these people out here scamming folks, that just boils my blood, I will tell you. Well, you are listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV. You can give us a call at 855-765-1045. We're going to take a quick break, and we will be right back. Welcome back. Welcome back, Jacksonville. We've had some very interesting calls so far today, and it looks like we have another caller. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah, of course. I'm here with Eddie and Chuck. So let's get to our next caller, Sam in St. Augustine. You have a question about automobile liability. What's going on? You there, Sam? Okay.
Yes, I am.
Go ahead. You there?
Yes, I am.
All right. What's going on, Sam?
I've got a question about automobile liability.
Okay.
I have a daughter who has a son, and he's turning 16. He's getting ready to start driving in July. And I adopted him, my grandson, because his father died when he was an infant. So I'm his legal guardian, and my daughter is also. Now he's going to start driving, and I wonder what my financial responsibility would be if he gets into an automobile accident.
Did you? Okay, you said two different things. Are you his guardian, or did you adopt him?
I adopted him.
Legally in court. There's a court order. You are now considered his father.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So, if he's driving your vehicle. And
no, it'd be my daughter's vehicle be driving. My name will not be nowhere on any automobile he drives.
Okay. If it's not on the title, if your name's not on the title, then you have no responsibility. The only responsibility, the only responsibility you would have when he applied for his driver's license, whoever signed the permit for him to be driving, to get the license, you're on the hook till he's 18.
Okay. Well, my daughter will be signing for his driver's license
then
all that.
You're okay. If he's not driving your vehicle that's in your name and your name's not on his car and you didn't sign the application for him to get a driver's license, you're okay.
Okay. Well, let me ask you another question about this. If I was to get sued, let's say I was on the title, and I have a joint bank account with my wife, can they attach that money if it's a joint account?
Oh, they could not if the car is in your name alone. If your wife's on the car with you, they can attach a joint account.
No.
But if you have a joint account with your wife as tenants by the entirety, that's how it should be titled.
Uh-huh.
Like Sam and Susie, as tenants by the entirety, a joint account, and the car's in your name alone, and you cause an accident, they can't touch your joint money.
Okay, that's good. That's but anyway, thing. I'm in the clear if the car's in my daughter's name, then, right?
But
that's
really, the safest way. But really, you and your wife, the way I did it in my household, and you, your car that you drive should be in your name alone, and your wife's car should be in her name alone.
That well, means, we only have one car. I don't okay. drive.
Okay, all right. Never mind. It doesn't apply to you then.
The car is in both our names, but she's the only driver because I'm blind. Okay. And they won't let me drive.
Yeah, but you should take your car out of their name. You should put it in her name alone. Because if she causes an accident, see, right now, it's in both names.
It's just in her name. Oh, just the in her name. Was in both our names.
Okay, that's good.
Okay, yeah.
If the car is in her name alone, then whatever you own jointly with your wife cannot be attached, cannot be gone after.
Well, very good. I do appreciate it. Yeah. Hey, you know, one time I used you about 30 years ago. You won't remember me, but it was an adoption for my son, for my wife's first marriage. You've been around a long time.
I mean, I've been doing it for a long time. Back then, I was doing adoptions.
Aww.
Yes, she was.
That's a long, it was probably over 30 years ago. Probably,
I think you
wanted
actually, it was 32 years ago because it was when he turned 18.
Yeah, yeah. Aww. Well, that's fantastic. I'm glad. And thanks for letting me know that, Sam.
Wow,
appreciate
Sam.
It.
I love that. He was back when you were just starting
that's
off.
That's the old days, Sam. I know.
Yeah, you didn't charge. I think you want to charge me like I think $100 or something, $150.
Man,
don't ask him what he charged
then,
now, Sam.
I ain't gonna ask.
Well, Sam, $100 was money back then. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that's true.
Yes, it was.
Yeah,
I do appreciate it, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
That's so beautiful. Thank you for calling, Sam. That was a great question, and I'm so happy that the Farah and Farahs were able to help you build your family. And that's beautiful. Look at that. All right. That just warmed my heart.
Yeah.
Well, why don't you take it away? I know you started the show today with some
stuff. I got a lot of things I want to talk about, but we've been having so many interesting calls today.
That's true.
I kind of think that's taking a priority. But, this Roe v. Wade thing that's out there, I mean, that's a legal topic.
Woo.
I don't know what people think about that, what's happening, the cat's out of the bag now.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like Roe v. Wade is a thing of the past. There's a lot of controversy about it. It's divided down between the conservatives and the liberals, and so I don't know if people have ideas on all that. We'll see, we'll see what kind of law. I mean, now it's up to the state. What they're doing is saying it's not a federal thing anymore. Each state can now dictate what the law is in that state.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't understand it. I mean, okay, you can't get an abortion in Florida, but you can go to, Mississippi or Alabama or.
Well, I don't know about Mississippi, but you could go to like Colorado or something,
Colorado,
Oregon.
But
question is about this, is that, the states have the rights now, if they want to make laws about this. But what about criminalizing?
Yeah, they can probably do that.
Abortions. That's an interesting development.
Yeah, there's some thinking. Some states may consider it homicide.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
So
and
there's a
what?
Lot going to be happening as a result
charged.
Of that. I know that, it's. It's a big deal.
It is a big deal.
I kind of felt it was going to happen, with the makeup of the court. I kind of thought that was the road.
Really?
I just saw it. I knew this thing would not be around. I knew Roe v. Wade would not be around long. I think just the whole.
Wow.
You got to look. I'm going to talk about it. There is a case. There is a case that was decided last week along, it was 6-3, conservative versus liberal. And it was a case having to deal with. I just feel that the court is starting to, you can see those not party lines, but those philosophies kind of making decisions. Last week, there was a 6-3 decision, 6 conservative, 3 liberal, which struck down this this lawsuit, and it was based on the 6-3 was based on the philosophy of these justices, but it had to do with a lady who was deaf, and was legally blind, and she went to she had to go to physical therapy. She had a back problem, and so her doctor said, "You need to go get some physical therapy." So she goes to the physical therapist, and she says, "I need to have a sign language interpreter. That's how I communicate." And the physical therapy company said, "No, you got to bring your own interpreter. We're not going to have somebody here to it." So she left to go to another therapist, and she comes back and she sues the physical therapy for discrimination. And they should have had somebody there. And this particular physical therapy company accepts Medicare and Medicaid, so they have to comply with federal laws on discrimination. And the Affordable Care and Rehabilitation Act, when you accept money from the government, you must agree not to discriminate based on race, sex, age, or disability. So this company was accepting money from the government, this physical therapy company. Therefore, they had to abide by the Affordable Care and Rehabilitation Act. Mm-hmm. So she wanted to sue for emotional distress, like pain and suffering and mental anguish. And the conservative members of the court said, no, this, even though you were maybe discriminated against, and that you could only sue for contractual damages, because really the physical therapy company had a contract with the federal government. And therefore, you can only get damages that you can get under a contract, like just like we talked about at the beginning. Mm-hmm. I want my deposit back of 10 grand. Mm-hmm. I mean, that person who is like, I forgot her name. Was it
Linda?
Linda. Is it Diane? No.
Linda.
Linda. Like Linda's daughter can't sue for pain and suffering because they didn't put her pool in, and her,
right.
She can get her 10 grand back, but you can't sue for emotional damages in a contractual situation, typically. Mm. So in this case, the court said, no, even though you were a victim of discrimination, you can only sue for a breach of contract. You can't get emotional damages. And the liberal members of the court said, no, that's not correct. That it's always, you can, there's all kind of discrimination type causes of action, mm-hmm. where people get emotional damages. You know, that's part of the lawsuit.
Right.
And but the liberal guy, the conservative court said, no, it's a breach of contract. You get only if you're out of pocket something. And so that's kind of what that happened right before Roe v. Wade. It was a few days before it. So you can kind of see what the court's doing. You got the six conservatives, you got the three, or whoever the makeup is, 5-4, 6-3. Mm. But there is a majority of conservatives on the court. And so you're starting to get these conservative opinions coming down. And we'll see what happens. It's interesting to watch that develop.
Yeah, we will see what happens.
I mean, Trump was able to appoint two Supreme Court judges.
That's true.
So,
that's true.
You know, people don't think, you know, you always think about, you know, you got these elections, and you vote, you know, we vote for people we want to get in thinking they're going to really change policy. But really, the Supreme Court, both in Florida and at a national level, these guys have a lot of power.
And they're lifelong positions.
Exactly.
The rest
they're
of their
lifelong.
Life.
They have no, they're forever. And so when you vote for, when you're making a decision of who to vote for, you always have to always anticipate, well, is that person going to be able to appoint, you know, somebody to the Supreme Court of the state or at a national level, because it's a big deal. And you can see it unraveling. You can see it happening right here.
Wow. Yeah. I'm surprised that you saw it coming.
Oh,
I found it surprising. I was
Roe v. Wade
a little
was on the way out.
Shocked about it, but it was alleged, you know, draft of an opinion about striking Roe v. Wade down and giving the power back to the states. I mean, it's probably going to happen.
Yeah,
I get it.
Yeah, it's probably a done deal. I think it's a done deal, but I mean, you could tell anytime anybody was. I'm sorry.
Turn your phone off.
Yeah, I know.
We are live on air.
The response.
These spam calls, you know.
Oh, I know. They call all the time.
I'll sell your home.
Or it's a bill collector.
I'll sell your home. Let me sell your home. Wow.
But, yeah,
it's
yeah.
It's fascinating.
Yeah. So
we'll be right back after this quick break. But you're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV. Give us a call. We got a few more minutes. We'd love to hear from you. 855-765-1045. We'll be right back, and we'll keep it going. All right, guys, we are back. You're listening to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah. I'm Shafalik, and I'm joined here by Eddie and Chuck. We've got two callers on the line and 10 minutes to go, so let's jump right in. Let's get to work, yes. Paul from the West Side, you've got a traffic accident question. What's going on, Paul?
I just wondered, in a non-injury traffic accident, relatively minor, should you call for a police officer or not? It seems that the police don't really want to mess with it.
No.
They come because they have to, and the insurance company kind of wants you to do it. So should you do?
Well, you know, you could exchange information. It's up to the other driver. You got to have both of them. I mean, you can typically, the person who's not at fault wants a police officer there. or a community service officer. I think they send community service officers out first. If there's no injury, they don't even – I don't think a police officer has time to even show up. But, you know, if y'all can exchange information, and because really the police officer who comes there, and even if he gives the person a ticket, the ticket is not admissible in a court of law. I mean, there's nothing to really be gained. If you're getting all the information from the other side, there's nothing that the police officer can add because he can't testify who was at fault because he didn't see the accident. It's hearsay.
Yeah. So he, I mean, the insurance company, like I said, wants it because it makes it easier for them to decide who's, which side is going to take.
I know, but the insurance company, but remember, the accident report that the police officer prepares is not admissible in a court of law to figure out who was at fault.
Okay, so you're cool just exchanging information.
Right. I mean, to me, I think
in
those
reality, though, is if he writes a report and does a little investigation there and his report shows that one or the other is responsible, then the insurance company may rely on that and pay the claim.
But if you have a legitimate defense to it, they're going to take your position. Yeah. I mean, if Paul gets the ticket and Paul says, no, I did not run the stop sign or I did not run the red light, your insurance company is going to back you up. They're going to say Paul didn't run the stop sign or the red light, and we're going to back Paul up. I don't care what the accident report says. I mean, that's what I see.
Well, that's cool because I figured the police had more important things to do.
They do. They do. And
one thing you got to do is take photographs of the damage of the scene, where the cars ended up at the impact site, so that, you know, you can have something to go back on in case the other person denies that they were responsible.
Yeah, I tell you, we
got to have something like that. Otherwise, that kind of evidence fades away. And
yeah, you take a picture of the driver's light, of the tag, and get his driver, a picture of his driver's light, all that. You can do it on your own. But most of the time, it's hard to get both parties to agree to do that. It's always somebody that wants the police there. But I tell you, I see it all the time. We get cases where the other side got the ticket, and you get on the phone with the insurance company. Well, we talked to our guy, and he said he had the green light, and we're going to take his position because they have a duty to support their insured, and if they believe what he's telling them, even if he received the ticket, they're going to deny liability. Hmm. So so the ticket, everybody who believes the accident report, unless there are witnesses on that accident report that you can talk to, then hey, they ain't no good. I mean, it's just hearsay. The whole report is hearsay.
Well, one other quick question. Who is Dahlia Farah? I see her on the billboard signs. She's a pretty girl.
Yeah, that's my daughter there.
Who is she? That's your daughter?
Yep.
Better be careful, Paul.
I'll pass the message on to her.
You talking to Daddy Farah over
working.
Here.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I've got somebody looking. I'll talk to my billboard company, make sure they're doing. Tell them they're doing a good job. Now, I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you guys for everything.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Paul, for calling. We do have one last caller. We got Nelson with a house-related question. What's going on, Nelson?
Hey, Nelson.
A few years ago, I got a new manufactured house. I spent a little over $100,000 for. And from the get-go, the roofing was bad where it leaks a little bit, and the trim was bad, the counters are bad. The kitchen, both bathrooms, got cuts in the vinyl flooring. I had the company come out, and they tried to fix things a little bit at a time, never got it done. Now the company is gone, changed names. I'm not sure what to do from here.
Okay.
Is there somebody I could sue?
How long has it been?
This summer be 3 years.
Okay. What kind of warranty did it come with?
I'm not sure. I mean, it was never good from the get go, and they knew that.
I know that, but did you put them on notice that it was not good?
I got a UAW attorney called them and let them know that this wasn't right and it needed to be fixed, and that's when they changed names.
We may have somebody in our office that can handle that for you.
We have an attorney that deals with warranty issues.
Yeah. Was the company here in Florida?
I'm in outside of Gainesville, Florida.
I'll tell you, Paul, why don't you leave your phone number with our producer, and I've got somebody who can get in touch with you on Monday on that.
That'd be great.
Yeah,
Thank you so much.
To help you. We have an attorney in our office now. It's fairly, we kind of started about a couple of years ago, who handles all these kind of breach of warranty claims, like when it comes to motorhomes, RVs, cars, motorcycles, boats, anything that has a warranty. There's a federal law that can help you out. So I'll have him probably give you a call on Monday if you leave the number.
Okay, that'll be great.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Nelson. Daniel will be taking your number shortly.
Yeah.
A lot of times on those warranty claims, the company has to pay our attorney's fee.
Yeah.
So
The
consumer doesn't have to come out with money out of their pocket up front to get us involved.
Yeah,
so
this federal law, the Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act, is so powerful. It's a federal law, and it covers anything that's under a warranty. I've seen him, this is kind of a new area of law for us, but in talking to the attorney in our office, Josh, who handles it, I mean, if you have a car that you've taken in or a boat you've taken back two or three times, it's under warranty and they can't fix it, you're entitled for damages for that.
Oh, wow.
I didn't know that. Yeah, it's really interesting. I mean, it doesn't have to, technically, a toaster that has a warranty with it.
Interesting.
Anything with a warranty.
Yeah.
He deals
boats
with
boats and RVs. You can,
yeah, jet skis, really motorcycles. Yeah.
Oh, wow. I should tell my dad about that. Yeah, he has an RV, or he has a little casita now, and he put on a hitch to his vehicle, and it messed up the electronics, and he had to go to the dealership and figure it out. Like, wait, what's going on? And then they figured out it was somebody else's hitch that you put on, and the warranty, I think.
They try to say voided the warranty or something.
Well, no, but it was supposed, they fixed it, and they actually took all the cost on them, and they went to the other company and said, now you're going to pay us. You messed up our car. So I don't know if that's the same thing.
Yeah, it's a little different.
That's different.
These are situations like this guy, like with Paul. Paul's taken, he's called him out there several times.
Right.
He's continuing to have problems. They can't fix it. They can't make the repair. So technically he has a case probably.
The first thing people think of is a lemon law, but it's not really a lemon law. I mean, it's similar to it, but it's lemon law is a state law, but this is a federal act that gives the consumer power because they don't have to pay. It's a fee shifting thing, so the fees are paid by the at fault party, which is normally the company. So
I see. Suing. Okay, and so this was called the Mass and
Magnuson-Moss Act.
Magnuson,
it's a federal
Moss.
Law.
Yeah, I'm gonna look that up.
Yeah, it's a very powerful statute, and there are attorneys that do nothing but this. He's helping. It's amazing. We started doing it. How many calls we get? So many people are needing help.
Yeah, I can imagine.
You know what's happened with COVID and everything, and people are, they're just kind of throwing these things out there.
Yeah.
They probably don't have enough people to work on them. And
that's true.
And people are
That's what I love about this show. I learn something new every week. I'm going to look that up. Thank you so much for listening to The Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. We will talk to you guys next week at noon. Feel free to give us a call next week at 855-765-1045. Thank you so much for listening.